Hello and welcome. And thank you for joining us here at IGF. It's good to have you here. Daylight savings time. We lost an hour of sleep. Some people are hurting for that, but we didn't have to be at church this morning, so that actually was great. So it's been a week of thinking about light, and so I kind of put some thoughts together around the theme of light. Changing time got me thinking about light this week. So light is good. And although you know what it is, I brought a few samples of lights because I know that everybody loves an object lesson. So, candlelight. Imagine doing all of your tasks with candlelight. And some of you can remember this era, and I would love to hear your stories. So, candlelight is one way that people used to actually light their homes in the evenings, probably, or if they had a dark house, they used them. We have oil lanterns. Some people used oil lanterns. We have mood lights. We have task lights. We have spotlights. We have all sorts of lights in our homes. We have flashlights. This is a little tiny one. Flashlights. We have book lights. Book lights? Everyone's got a book light. You need one in your trailer so you don't wear out the battery. We have headlights on our vehicles. Headlamps. What a great thing to have along when you go out, especially in the wintertime, and you're out longer than you're supposed to have been, so you can actually get back to your truck. So headlamps are a great thing when you're hiking or biking. But in keeping with the English language, we need to think about the challenges of using the words properly. And there are many meanings of the word light. When someone gets too serious in a conversation, people will interject, "Hey, lighten up, will ya?" Or when we climb on the scales after Christmas, or maybe a year of COVID isolation, and you say to yourself, "I was once lighter than this." Or, I received an email note the other day from a company and it said, "It's lighter longer," and they were trying to encourage me to shop for running and fitness gear. Like running, no, I'm not going there, but anyways, I digress. So I looked up some references to light in scripture. So let's quickly look at those. I found three references that I'd like to talk about. The first one is that Jesus is the light, and that we are the light. So Jesus is the light of the world, and we are the light of the world. In Matthew 5:14, Jesus says, "I am the light of the world. He who follows me will not walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." Psalm 119:105 says, "You are the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hidden." And it sort of reminds me of the little song we used to sing when we were kids, and we still sing it in church. This little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. So we have an opportunity to be different in the world. Jesus is the light of the world, and we are his messengers to shine his light in the community. So let's be different. Let's be patient. Let's be kind. Let's display grace to those around us and be light in our community this week and always. The second one is that God's word is a light to us. 1 John 1:5 says, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. When we're planning for a trip, we often get out some maps and brochures, and we research the journey, and we prepare ourselves, and we might even talk to someone who has taken that journey before, that trip, and say, "Hey, you know, where did you go? Where did you stay? What did you do?" Well, we're on a journey of life, and God's word is full of encouragement and guidance for us on this journey. And we have experienced people all around us who've been on this journey longer than us. So take time to chat with them and learn from them. And take time to read God's word that will provide guidance for your feet and light for the path ahead of us. And the third one is his burden is light. In Matthew 11:28-30, Jesus says, "Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light." There may be some who are weary. We've had a really interesting and challenging year. And I don't think, maybe some of you don't do this, but I sometimes tend to go to God, go to his throne with my burdens, and I say, "God, here's this problem, and here's this situation, and here's this person that I'm feeling burdened about." And so I pray about it. And then before I kind of leave that throne of God, that throne of grace, I kind of pick up those burdens and put them back on my back, and I walk away. And so the challenge for us all is to say that Jesus says his burden is light, and he can carry those burdens for us. You serve a very powerful God who is very willing and able to help us. And he sees the big picture, unlike us. He can lighten our load. His burden is light. So as we adjust to daylight savings time this week, let's ponder these thoughts. Jesus is the light of the world, and we are the light of the world. God's word is a light for us, and his burden is light. Let's just open in a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you're with us. We thank you that when the name of Jesus is spoken, all of heaven is attentive. And we know that you care, that you know us intimately. You know exactly where each one is at in their individual situations right here, right now. And I pray for those who are in the world and want to be a light. I pray that you would give us the words to say, the words not to say, but help us to be that different person, that person that people say, why are they different? That we could be light in your world and be your feet on the ground here. We also pray that we would remember that your word is a light to us and that we would turn to you often and turn to your word and also turn to others and get guidance through them. And also we pray this week that each one would remember that your burden is light. And as we have so many who are hurt and bewildered and grieving and who are sick and need healing touches, I pray that each of us would remember that your burden is light and we need to take our burdens to you and that you can carry them so much better than us. And we thank you for your love and your goodness. We pray for this service that it would speak to hearts that are listening. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
I would just like to encourage you to join us in singing today, this morning. And just let's just bring our hearts together in worship to God. And we're going to sing some songs about who he is and who we are through him. We're going to start off with 10,000 Reasons. And the other title for this song is Bless the Lord. And that's what we do with our music. We bless the Lord with it.
It's all. My living hope. You are here. As pastor of an Anabaptist church that values nonviolence and peace and loving your enemy, I sometimes find myself in a little bit of a dilemma. You see, I also value nonviolence and peace, but at the same time, I'm drawn to stories about war. War makes for such compelling drama. It brings out the best and the worst in people. During war, there are stories of bravery and sacrifice, and sometimes stories of overcoming impossible odds. For example, I think about the rescue of the Allied troops at the shores of Dunkirk. You may recall the incident. It was early in World War II. British and French soldiers had been driven back and were trapped at Dunkirk with the ocean at their backs. They were surrounded by German soldiers, and it looked like a huge disaster in the making. There were nearly 400,000 soldiers taking refuge near Dunkirk, and British intelligence estimated that the Navy would only be able to rescue about 47,000 of them. But then the British made an unusual move. They called on British citizens everywhere who had seaworthy vessels to join the rescue effort. And in the end, there were almost 1,000 boats, pleasure yachts, fishing boats, even ferries that answered the call to cross the dangerous English Channel. And with this flotilla of civilian boats, 338,000 soldiers were rescued. What looked like a complete disaster turned into one of the greatest rescue operations of all time. I love stories like that. And while war provides inspiring stories, stories of bravery, it also provides stories of human tragedy and atrocities. In times of war, it seems that life can become so cheap. And you know, these atrocities, they're not just committed by people who are on the other side, but also much closer to home as well. War is both immeasurably tragic and yet very compelling. Now, why am I talking about war? Obviously, it's not Remembrance Day. Well, in the biblical story that we're going to be looking at today, Israel faces their first battle as a nation. And as you know, even if you're just a little bit familiar with the Old Testament, this isn't going to be their last battle. It's the first of many. And so today, I want to do two things. First of all, I want to tackle that prickly question about why God commands Israel to destroy and drive out the inhabitants of Canaan. You know, as a follower of Jesus, these commands present a bit of a conundrum. How do we balance what Jesus taught in the Sermon on the Mount, for instance, with what we read here in the Old Testament? And then secondly, after looking at that question, I also want to point out Israel's unique battle strategy and what we can learn from Israel's battle strategy for our spiritual battle today. So let's begin then by reading from Exodus chapter 17, verse 8 through 16. This is the word of the Lord. The Amalekites came and attacked the Israelites at Rephidim. Moses said to Joshua, "Choose some of our men and go out and fight the Amalekites. Tomorrow I will stand on top of the hill with the staff of God in my hands." And so Joshua fought the Amalekites as Moses had ordered. And Moses, Aaron, and Hur went to the top of the hill. And as long as Moses held up his hands, the Israelites were winning. But whenever he lowered his hands, the Amalekites were winning. And when Moses' hands grew tired, they took a stone and put it under him so he could sit on it. Aaron and Hur held up his hands, one on one side and one on the other, so that his hands remained steady till sunset. And so Joshua overcame the Amalekite army with the sword. Then the Lord said to Moses, "Write this on a scroll as something to be remembered. And make sure that Joshua hears it, because I will completely blot out the name of Amalek from under heaven." Moses built an altar and called it, "The Lord is my banner." He said, "Because hands were lifted up against the throne of the Lord will be at war against the Amalekites from generation to generation." Well, let's first think about the Old Testament and war, shall we? What's up with all the wars and the battles that we read about in the Old Testament? How are we to understand this, particularly as followers of Jesus? You know, there are times, of course, when the Bible records all manner of violent acts, not because that's what God wanted to happen, but because people were sinful, they were violent, they were power hungry. In other words, sometimes the Bible is simply being descriptive. This is the way it was, and not necessarily being prescriptive, saying this is the way it ought to be. However, when we are confronted with the battles of the conquest, it's a different story. In these battles, it is God who is telling Israel to completely destroy and drive out the inhabitants of the land. And we're faced with this question, is God committing genocide? Is God advocating ethnic cleansing? What do we make of this? And I want to suggest to you today three guiding principles here. Now, this may not answer all the questions that you might have about this, but at least it's a starting point. First of all, we need to understand the wickedness of the people of Canaan. We need to see the command of God in the context of the lives of the Canaanites. Some critics, if you would listen to the way that they describe the conquest, you would get the impression that the Canaanites were just innocent peasants living peaceably in the land when this sociopath Joshua comes and kills their women and children. But is that really the way it was? I don't think so. We need to understand who these Canaanites are. And to start with, let's take a quick look at the Amalekites that we're introduced to here in Exodus chapter 17. The Amalekites are descendants of Esau, Jacob's twin brother. According to one historian, the Amalekites were a nomadic people who lived by attacking others and plundering their wealth. And it's believed that the Amalekites may have been the ones who domesticated the camel and then employed them in the use of warfare so that they could rush in on these camels and plunder a people, attack a people, and then rush out again. It's kind of an ancient version of Blitzkrieg, lightning war. And this lines up well with what Moses describes in Deuteronomy chapter 25, verse 17 through 18. In these verses, Moses says, "Remember what the Amalekites did to you along the way when you came up out of Egypt." And he's referring to this incident here in Exodus 17. "When you were weary," Moses writes, "when you were weary and worn out, they met you on your journey and attacked all who were lagging behind. They had no fear of God." The Amalekites were opportunists, attacking vulnerable and weak people. Now, of course, the Amalekites were just one of many people groups that lived in Canaan and who were being driven from the land. And if you want a picture of the moral condition of the people who dwelt in the land of Canaan, you should read Leviticus chapter 18. Now, in Leviticus 18, Israel is given this long laundry list of things that they are not to do, sins to avoid. It includes things like incest, in fact, all manner of incest, and rape, and bestiality, and child sacrifice. And then God adds in verse 24, "Do not defile yourselves in any of these ways, because this is how the nations that I'm going to drive out before you became defiled." In other words, this laundry list of sin, this child sacrifice, and all the sexual perversion that was pervasive and that is being described in this chapter, this describes the people of Canaan. And God is bringing judgment on them. We need to understand why God was judging these people. Secondly, we also need to see that even in God's judgment, there is grace. There is grace in the judgment of God. It wasn't like God hadn't already been patient with the people of Canaan. In fact, according to Genesis 15, God waited over 400 years before he would fulfill the promise that he made to Abraham to give Abraham's descendants the land. And he waited for this lengthy period of time because, the Bible says, the sin of the people had not yet reached its full measure. God was being patient with them. And even when Joshua begins the conquest, we still see that God is merciful to those who repent. Like the prostitute Rahab, for example. We read in the biblical record how she was a resident in the city of Jericho. And she understood that God was judging her people and that the Lord was going to give the Israelites their land. And so she hid the Israelite spies when they came to spy out the city. And she protected them. And she asked that because I have done this, be merciful to me when the Lord gives you the land and to my family. And so she was told, gather whoever belongs into your household and whoever you can convince and have them in your home and you will be spared. And you know that later on, Rahab becomes a part of the ancestry of King David. In fact, she becomes part of the ancestry of Jesus Christ himself. And so God is merciful. We also read, and on a number of occasions, that Israel is not just to destroy the people, but to drive them out of the land, which suggests that the Canaanites would be spared if they would surrender the land to Israel as a part of God's judgment on them. But instead, of course, many Canaanites stayed and they chose to fight. And thirdly, so God is gracious even in judgment, but thirdly, we need to also remember that God has the right to judge. As judge of the earth, God commanded Israel to act on his behalf, to be an instrument of judgment on the people of Canaan. But lest Israel become proud, God also warns the Israelites that if they become like the people of Canaan and they fall into the same sin, that the land will spit them out as well. And that's exactly what eventually happens. And this time God uses the Assyrian armies, the Babylonian armies, to drive the people out of the land, his own people. And so as a holy God, the Lord not only has the right, but he has the obligation to judge sin and wickedness. Now that begs the question, does God still use his people to execute judgments on the ungodly? Are we to think of ourselves as a Christian nation whom God is calling to wage war against the ungodly? I know that some people look at it that way, but I don't believe so. And the reason I say this is because Jesus taught us a new understanding of the kingdom of God and what it means to be a part of his kingdom. When Jesus came into the world, he declared the coming of the kingdom of God. But this kingdom wasn't going to be a political kingdom with armies and borders like Israel was. Instead, the kingdom of God is a collection of people from all nations and languages and tribes and people, everyone who confesses the name of Jesus Christ as Lord. And as a result, there is no Christian nation, only Christian people who allow Christ to reign in their life. And that's the New Testament perspective on kingdom. Now, obviously, where there is a large concentration of Christians in a nation, it will have an influence on the nation. But I don't think that that makes a nation Christian. And so as a result, God's kingdom is found throughout the world, even in countries like Russia, North Korea, Iraq, even Canada. The kingdom of God doesn't advance through political power and physical warfare. Jesus made this statement when he was arrested and brought before Pilate. He said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight. But now, my kingdom is from another place." John 18, verse 36. Our citizenship is in heaven, and that's where our primary loyalty and allegiance lies. Now, please understand that that doesn't mean that God has abdicated his role as judge. God is still the judge. And the good news in the book of Revelation is that God is on the throne, and ultimately he will judge the earth and its inhabitants with justice and with truth, and he will set all things right. But for us as citizens in the kingdom of God, that's no longer our role. As Paul writes, we are not to take revenge, but we are to leave room for the wrath of God. Instead, the battle we engage in is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers and against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Ephesians 6, verse 12. And so when you read the Old Testament, understand that at that time, God was working through a particular nation, the people of Israel. He was using them to bring both judgment and redemption into the world, to be his agents. But today, the kingdom of God is different. And the weapons that we fight with are not the weapons of the world. So let's take a look then at the lessons that we can learn for our spiritual battle. We're going to switch gears here a little bit. And I want to briefly point out three strategies for victory that we can glean from Exodus chapter 17. The first principle to spiritual victory is take action. Moses and Israel win this battle by rolling up their sleeves and getting to work. Now, there are times like at the Red Sea where God tells Israel, just stand back and let me do the work. And he does the deliverance. But normally, God works in partnership with his people. And so Moses and Joshua gather some of the men of Israel and lead them into battle against the Amalekites. And even today, God chooses to work in partnership with his people. Jesus refers to the church as his body. We are his presence here in this world. We are his hands and feet. And when God wants to move, when he wants to work in the world, he chooses to work through you and I, the church. And in the struggle to advance the kingdom of God in the world, God calls us to action. He calls us to share the gospel, to disciple believers, to love our neighbor, to even love our enemy. And when you see need around you, and you're thinking to yourself, I wish somebody would do something about this. You know, it may well be that God is actually putting that on your heart and tapping you on the shoulder and saying, I want you to take action. Or maybe you are experiencing a struggle with sin in your life and you just can't seem to shake it. And of course, you know, you cry out to the Lord for mercy and forgiveness and you ask for help. But it may also mean that you need to take action, maybe by making yourself accountable to a Christian brother or sister, or maybe by removing the triggers to temptation so that you don't fall into the same traps again and again. God calls us to action, but he doesn't call us to act alone. And that leads us to the second part. The second principle is that we need to seek God. Take action, but also seek God. Behind Joshua's call to battle is Moses' call to stand over the people, to go up on the hill and to raise his hands before the Lord and intercede for the people. The text tells us that when Moses' hands and staff were lifted up, the people of Israel were winning. But when he grew tired and his hands came down, the battle turned around and the Amalekites began to win. And so as a result, Aaron and Hur supported Moses by holding his hands up until the battle was complete. And it's an amazing picture of the importance of prayer. You see, Israel's success was never based solely on their own strength and resources. It was never about their own strength or resources. And we see this in some of the very strange battle strategies that the Lord asks Israel to be a part of. You know, in Jericho, for example, you probably are familiar with the story. They march around the city one time each day until the seventh day. They march around it seven times. And then at the end, they are to blow trumpets and shout. What kind of battle strategy is that? Well, it worked. The walls came down, and it was a reminder to Israel that victory doesn't depend on human power or strength. The battle is the Lord's. We also see another classic example of a strange battle strategy in the life of Gideon. Gideon is called by God to fight against the Midianites, to free Israel from the oppression of the Midianites. And so Gideon finally, after reluctantly accepting this call, gathers an army of 32,000 soldiers of Israelites. But God says, you've got too many of them. If you go into battle with all of these people, you're going to say to yourself, I won this battle. And so the Lord gets Gideon to go through this process of whittling down his army until finally he goes from an army of 32,000 and ends up with an army of 300, less than 1% of the original army. Now, God says, I'm ready to work. And he brings victory to the Israelites. God wants Israel to know that victory is not gained by strength and resources, but by the power of God. And it's the same is true for us today. Yes, God calls us into action, but action needs to be done in humble dependence on the power of God. We need people who are willing to roll up their sleeves and work and volunteer and take action. But we also need people who will stand behind them in prayer, lifting up these ministries and this action before the Lord and calling on his power. And so with that in mind, let me just share with you something that our church board is starting this year. You may remember that our mission statement that's printed on the front page of the bulletin. Remember the bulletins? It's been a long time since we've actually handed some out on a Sunday morning. But on the front page of this bulletin is our mission statement. And this mission statement contains six specific activities or purposes of the church: to worship God, to grow in maturity, to care for one another, to serve the community, to be engaged in local evangelism and world missions. And so what we've done is we've assigned each board member one of these specific purposes and tasked them with the responsibility of overseeing it and giving direction, setting goals, and working in partnership with those who are already involved in these areas. And that's the doing part. But this year, if you are on the prayer chain, you will also be asked and have been asked to pray for two of these very specific purposes. And so from time to time, you should be hearing from a board member inviting you to pray and join in this work by praying and upholding to the Lord the goals, the activities, and the mission of this statement. And it's one of the ways that we can combine doing with depending. And if you're not a part of the prayer chain, but would also like to be part of this way of supporting the work of the church, the ministry of the church, please feel free to contact me, and I'll make sure that you can get onto this email list as well, and they can send out prayer requests to you as well. I think it's also a good way for you as a congregation to know the things that we are engaged in, and so that you're also more connected to the going-ons of the church. So Joshua is down in the valley, battling. Moses is up on the hill, praying. And in the same way, we need both people, both kinds of people, to experience victory in the spiritual battles before us. So take action, seek God. But the third principle is perhaps one that we miss out on a little bit more. And that is to celebrate the victories. Celebrate and remember victory. Notice that after the victory over the Amalekites is won, the Lord says to Moses, write this on a scroll as something to be remembered, and make sure that Joshua hears about it. Why is Joshua supposed to hear about it? Well, later on, he's going to become like the general of the Israelite army. He's the one who leads Israel into the battles when they reach the promised land. And because he will be leading the Israelites in these battles, he needs to know, to remember that victory depends on the Lord. And so Moses is to write down the memory of what has happened and transpired here. And then Moses builds an altar and calls it, "The Lord is my banner." A banner is a rallying point that draws the army and the soldiers together and points them in a direction. It gives them focus. And I think that's what the Lord is supposed to do for us. He is our rallying point. He gives us direction. He gives us focus. You know, I've just finished reading the book of Joshua. And it's interesting that as the Israelites go into the promised land and they're fighting their battles, seven times it mentions that the Israelites built an altar. And now these altars weren't for sacrificing to the Lord. They were all altars of remembrance. When Israel achieved major victory or learns a big lesson, they build an altar so that they would not forget the faithfulness of the Lord as he has called them into action. It was a way of celebrating and marking their victories. And I believe it's important for us to do the same thing as well. One of the ways to celebrate and mark God's victory in our lives and in our church is to share the stories of what God has done for you personally and for us collectively. I think sometimes we're shy about telling other people about what God has done in our life and about the struggles that we're facing. But we can support one another when we're open about these things. And then we can also celebrate together God, the victories that God brings. It strengthens faith. It gives joy. It reminds us that victory is found in the Lord. And if you have a story of victory, a story of struggle that you would like to share so that we can all kind of gather in and share this experience and battle with you, I think it would be great to have more testimonies, more sharing of these kinds of things. So what battles are you facing today? Perhaps health struggles? Struggles against sin or fear or anxiety? Maybe struggles to share the good news of the gospel with someone that you love and would dearly love to see them accept Christ. Let's take action where we can. Let's humbly depend on the power of God through prayer. And let's celebrate together the victories that he brings. Psalm 20, verse 6 to 7 says, "Now this I know, the Lord gives victory to his anointed. He answers him from his heavenly sanctuary with the victorious power of his right hand. Some trust in chariots, some trust in horses, but we trust in the name of the Lord our God." May that be true of us. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much that you have not left us as orphans, but you have indwelt us with the Holy Spirit. You have empowered us with the power of the resurrection to be your hands and your feet in this world. Help us to do, help us to pray, help us to celebrate in ways that will honor you. Father, for those who are discouraged right now, I pray that you would come around them and build them up and uphold them and show your hand in their lives. Thank you, God, for your faithfulness, for your goodness, faithfulness that is new every morning. Lord, give us strength as we go through this coming week, and we seek and we look up to you, and we pray this in the name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Just as we close this the service, I want to, we're going to see, show, have a video available for you to watch. And this video was sent to us by the conference office, and it's a beautiful song connected with pictures of all the missionaries who are out in the field doing, serving, acting on God's behalf. And it's a reminder that we are called to be their prayer warriors, to be their prayer support. And so enjoy this video. And also in the email that I sent out to you as a congregation, if you're on my email list, I have sent out prayer requests. Now there's a lot of missionaries there and probably won't have time to pray for all of them. But if there's one or two faces that you say, oh, I know that person, look them up and check out what they've written as prayer requests and ways that you can intercede for them. And let's take this week to especially pray for the activities, the mission activities of our conference. I hope you enjoyed. Have a good day.
Blessings flow again where fear too long has reigned. Lord, let the church bells ring from here to the nations on earth as in heaven. Lord, our prayer will ever be your kingdom come. Restore the mighty name of Christ the Son. Let prodigals return to raise your song. Our God has no rival. Our prayer is revival. Lord, hear the cry of saints, of those who yearn and come meet us in this place. We pray for the nations. We cry to the heavens. Lord, our prayer will ever be your kingdom come. Restore the mighty name of Christ the Son. Let the prodigals return to raise your song.